from the Institute of Bioinformatics and Biotechnology. It is a great privilege for me to introduce our speaker for today, Professor Andrey Shaly. He received his PhD from Birkbeck College, University of London, UK in 1991, where he developed the modular program for comparative modeling of protein structures. He was then a postdoc at Harvard University as a Jane Coffin Child Memorial Fund Fellow studying lattice Monte Carlo models of protein folding. He was first an assistant professor and then an associate professor at the Rockefeller University. He then moved to the University of California, San Francisco as a professor of computational biology in the Department of Bioengineering and Therapeutic Sciences, Department of Pharmaceutical Chemistry, and California Institute of Quantitative Biosciences. He was a Sinsheimer Scholar, an Alfred P. Sloan Research Fellow, the recipient of the Zoe Award of Science, Ambassador of Republic of Slovenia, and elected a Fellow of International Society for Computational Biology. He has been an editor of Structure since 2002. He is also a founder of Prospect Genomics that emerged with structural genomics and of Global Blood Therapeutics. Dr. Shaly develops and applies computational methods for determining and modulating structures and functions of proteins and their assemblies. Dr. Andrey Shaly is interested in using computation grounded in the laws of physics and theory of evolution to study the structure and function of proteins. His lab aims to improve and apply methods for predicting the structures of proteins, determining the structures of macromolecular assemblies, and annotating the functions of proteins using their structures. The two most often used programs developed by his research group include Modeler for comparative protein structure and modeling and IMP for integrative structure determination. Both Modeler, used for homology and comparative modeling of proteins, and IMP, integrative modeling platform that provides a comprehensive structure characterization of molecules, have provided with great breakthroughs in the field of structural biology. We are extremely grateful to Dr. Shaly for coming here today and giving us this talk on scientific modeling. Without further ado, please join me in welcoming Dr. Andrey Shaly.
Thank you very much for this introduction. It's always very nice to be introduced by students instead of faculty. And on that note, I would also like to encourage everyone, especially students, to interrupt me during the seminar with your questions or comments. Don't hesitate to do that. There should also be time, I hope, at the end for questions, but do it in the middle if you so feel. So today, I was asked to give a talk appropriate for the undergraduate students mostly. And I felt that making some rather general remarks about scientific modeling, illustrated by modeling in the field of structural biology, would be appropriate. To begin with, I would like to show you a model that almost certainly needs no introduction. This is just to get going. It is the double helix model of DNA. Nucleic acids that was proposed many, many years ago by James Watson and Francis Crick, who received the Nobel Prize a number of years later for this achievement. The original picture of this model is shown here, and as you know, it's been one of the most influential models in the whole of science, almost certainly in biology, with great impact on not just biology, but also biotechnology and medicine. It is difficult to imagine the world today without the benefits that resulted from this model and the understanding that this model brought. The model is a structural model describing, in this more modern picture, easier to see, the relationships, special relationships between the components, the nucleotides of DNA. It was based on the X-ray crystallography information on stoichiometric composition, chemical complementarity between the components of the model of the nucleotides, and was very suggestive about how genetic information is stored, transmitted, and through mutations modified or evolved. And now let's ask a question: what is a model? What is a scientific model? And try to answer it in a more general fashion than the single example before. A model can be defined as a description of a part of nature. And moreover, it's a description that's not directly measured by experiment. What's measured by experiment is data. So everything else but data, according to this definition at least, is a model. And then what happens is, well, there's really nothing else to science as a whole except for an experiment and a model, or experimentation and modeling, alternatively. The entire scientific effort is an iteration from or through performing experiments to via modeling to a model, which then results in the next generation of experiments, and so on. So I hope you can appreciate now the importance of models and modeling, and also that in fact every scientist, unless they are mindlessly tabulating experimental data, which no one does anymore, is also a modeler in his broad definition of modeling. Let's now illustrate the point where several additional models, scientific models, taken from structural biology area, just to clarify even more this definition. And then we'll be asking questions such as how does one construct a model, what are models useful for, and so on. The next model I'd like to share with you is a model of an atomic structure of a protein. You know, proteins are linear polypeptide chains consisting of 20 or so, depending whether they're natural or not, amino acid rescue types, and that the sequence of which is encoded by genes, but they function the way they do in cells, the proteins, because they assume, or most often, because they assume a certain three-dimensional shape with a certain dynamics to it. And so it's very important in biology to describe the structures of proteins, to construct models of protein structure. In this picture here shows the positions, Cartesian coordinates, x, y's, and z's, of each atom in a protein. Different atom types are colored in different colors, and they're connected with sticks representing chemical bonds. And that is a model of protein structure, is another example, just as we saw a model of nucleic acid structure previously. The next type of a model is shown here, so-called Ramachandran plot, which was proposed 54 years ago by G.N. Ramachandran, an Indian scientist of great impact. The model describes the conformational preferences of the peptide bond, schematically illustrated on the left. The preferences themselves are described in a plot spanned by the so-called phi dihedral angle. This is the dihedral angle in the peptide chain. And the psi dihedral angle on the y-axis, another dihedral angle in the peptide chain, using a combination of relatively simple computer calculations and his intuition and probably real space models, he proposed what particular combinations of fine cyclohedral levels describing the conformation of the polypeptide chain are stereochemically feasible and nicely identified the helical secondary structure, the sheet secondary structure, and some other less popular conformations of the polypeptide chain. This is a model. It's not something that you see by looking at the polypeptide chain or even through a microscope. It is a model. It is not measured directly by experiment. Another model of some different kind is that of a process in this case. Its scheme here shows an enzymatic reaction starting with an enzyme, a type of a protein, that interacts with the substrate molecule, and then through a series of steps, cleaves some bond in the substrate and produces two smaller product molecules. And the schematic of this process is a model. It's yet another kind of model. The generalization of such a model is that of a molecular network, such as this one here. Very often used in systems biology, cell biology in general, in fact, to illustrate how in a cell, represented by a rectangle, there are a number of different components, proteins, genes, various small molecules, that interact with each other in different ways, catalyze, inhibit, activate, transport, encode, and so on, in order to achieve a certain function. In this case, you see a relatively complicated network that describes the impact of metformin, one of the most widely used drugs, in fact, as it happens, for diabetes and some types of cancer on the cell. The impact of metformin is described through this network occurring inside the cell. And I hope you can appreciate it without too much argument, that knowing this network, one is in a much better position to modulate the system described by the network than without knowing the network model of it. And more briefly, two more models. Hopefully we'll firm up the intuitive understanding of what models are. The first one, there's a so-called molecular mechanics force field. It's a mathematical description of interactions between atoms in classical mechanics. So for example, this term here, harmonic term, defines the potential energy of a covalent bond as a function of distance between two atoms and their atom types. The next term would define an angle of three covalently bonded atoms, and so on. This kind of a model is often used to simulate both the structure and especially dynamics of molecules, including importantly biological molecules such as proteins, nucleic acids, and others. And then on the right side, I would like to give you possibly the simplest and the most mindless type of a model, but a model nevertheless. It doesn't even matter exactly what x and y are, but let's say that x is time and y is some position of some object, and you do measurements of the position of this object on the y function of time, and these measurements may be represented by dots. That's data. You can then fit a polynomial of some degree to the data, and you get a curve through the data points, and that curve is a model. You don't see a curve when you do an experiment. You see the points on the plot. To get a model, a very simple model, not particularly insightful, perhaps, you need to describe how the cell changes in time, not just take a snapshot of it. We would also like to have a model that allows us, that gives us a sense that we understand how the cell works. It's no use to have an accurate position of each atom in the cell at every femtosecond over a period of hours. That would be an accurate, very detailed model, but it would not give us a sense about what's really going on, what the principles and rules behind the cell are. And so we want that from the model as well. But we don't have that model yet. It's frustrating. We would like to have it. However, the reason why I'm showing this to you is because there is a sense in the community, or in a large part of the community, biological community, that we are poised to get going with collecting the right kind of data and developing the right kind of computational tools to construct this model. I think it's at the forefront of biology, this problem, requiring, of course, both experimentalists and theoreticians to collaborate. And perhaps some of you will directly or indirectly participate in this effort over the next X years. And enjoy at some point the results of this amazing effort if it succeeds. So these were some sample models. And now let's ask the question, what are the models based on? And again, answer it very broadly. At the end of the lecture, I will give you some more specific examples in case you're itching for more specifics. But for now, we'll stay broad. So models are based on information. What else can they be based on? There's nothing else. And information can come, in fact, from three different sources. So expanding a little bit on models being based only on experimental data. One source of information is indeed different kinds of experimental data that you measure on the object you're modeling or the process that you're modeling with different experiments. But information that limits what models are likely to be accurate can also come from general physical theories. And moreover, it can come from a statistical inference based on a sample of descriptions of systems that are not the system that you are interested in modeling, but have been characterized before. And you can now hope that in some respects they share some similarities with your system, so you can, through statistics, learn and limit what good models are about your particular system. And of course, you can be recursive a little bit and base a bigger model on models of some subset or system you're interested in. And this is actually just illustrated here with these icons. These are the various sources of information, and they are, in general, used to create models. In fact, as a side comment, I'd like to also mention that there's nothing wrong, if you do it right, to use your intuition or your guesses a little less glamorously as input into modeling as well, as long as you identify such input assumptions accordingly. It has to be true that a scientist's intuition is, in some indirect sense, dependent on his or her prior exposure to experiment statistics and physics. It's just not necessarily very clear exactly how intuition arises, a guess arises. Alternatively, you can just make an arbitrary guess or any kind of a guess, even if it's not particularly well defended, just to play what it means. And what if this is true? What would be the consequence for the model? It's okay in modeling as a tool to make progress. And so, slightly more concretely, in the case of protein structure models that you've already seen, they're often included based on information that comes from an X-ray crystallography experiment, where you take a crystal of the pure protein you're characterizing, expose it to X-ray beam, and observe an X-ray diffraction pattern on the detector, and then find those structures that are consistent with observed diffraction pattern. But in addition, you have to almost always use additional information, which will come invariably from a molecular mechanics force field. It is insufficient to compute models of protein structure just from X-ray crystallography data unless you have a very high resolution in the data that in general is not achieved. We need to tell the modeling program what the bond lengths between atoms are, if two atoms cannot be overlapping in space, and so on, based on a molecular mechanics force field, which is a reflection of physical theory. And often, also statistical preferences of protein structures observed from many previously determined protein structures are also incorporated. You want your protein structure to look statistically like other protein structures of other proteins previously determined. That is correlated with the accuracy of your final structural model, so you do it. And in some cases, you may even use previously determined protein structure models. For example, maybe this part was previously determined for a smaller polypeptide chain by experiment, and now you just graph it on the structural model of the bigger protein, as an example. So now that we looked at what are the models based in general, let's look at what is the purpose of a model. And I already indicated that a little bit, but I'll elaborate on it with this slide. Let me also say that some of these things may sound very general and quite obvious to you, but I actually myself find it quite useful to remind myself about these generalities from time to time. For example, when you're writing a paper about your work, and maybe you determine a structure of a protein, and then you need, and it's quite straightforward to describe how you determined it and how you and what it looks like. That's a no-brainer, you have to do that. But what else can you do in a paper? Right? You need to have a discussion section. What should I put in it so that the paper is more likely to be appreciated, accepted for publication, and so on? And it is useful to remind yourself systematically that here are some categories of why a model in general, including a protein structure model, is determined. So the purpose of a model is to allow us to understand the system, how it works, or how it functions. And it's also, sometimes at least, to allow us to modulate the system. When we looked at the molecular network, small molecules, another small molecule may impact on the network in a certain way. Maybe it's going to be a drug. That's modulation. We want to have a model of the system that we want to modulate, because it'll be easier to modulate it. And sometimes we may even want to design it. For biological systems, then it's a general statement for any kind of model, but for a biological system, often you want to, quote unquote, appreciate the evolutionary history of what you model, of some protein, for example. Because in biology, everything has to make sense, both in terms of physics as well as evolution. And a model of a, say, protein structure will often allow you to appreciate the evolution of that system better than without a model. Importantly, a model will also allow us to perform most informative new experiments that haven't been performed yet And one can in general imagine a million different experiments that could be done, but that's not feasible. Which ones do you want to do next? Well, having a model that outlines uncertainties, unanswered questions, for example, or some new questions that now suddenly become important that previously you were not even aware of without a model, gives you a way to rank, prioritize what additional work needs to be done in the experiment in the next iteration of the cycle of science. Importantly, models should be falsifiable, meaning that they should allow you to predict feasible new experiments, which can then in turn be used to validate or falsify a model. It does not, probably, at least in most cases, nothing is perhaps absolutely certain in science, a model that you cannot possibly find about its accuracy or lack thereof. Maybe it's not worth an effort to compute. And of course, when new data are measured, they can be used to improve the model in this cycle of science. So these are some purposes, generic purposes of the model. The next question is how to build a model, finally. While it's certainly true that models can be derived simply by thinking, as the double helix model of DNA was derived, and then described in words or pictures, that can be very useful, it is not generally preferable to do so. It is much better and desirable to construct a formal mathematical model using a very objective and reproducible process, such as a computer program or a set of equations, which will allow other people to do the same thing so that we are more confident. This is, in fact, I would put it the other way. The only way one can construct a model is to ask some person who then describes it in words. I think I would have much less confidence in the model they describe than when a model can be computed from very well-defined inputs through a very defined process, everything else being equal. And there's also issues of efficiency and so on. But I think we can agree that we want to construct as much as possible formal mathematical models using reproducible and objective modeling process. The bottom of the slide describes, as far as I can tell, the most general objective modeling process, which we'll go through in some more detail. But I'll just say before that, that of course it's possible to come up with models objectively with other kinds of modeling processes. Shortcuts that sometimes make sense because they're just simpler. Nevertheless, it is important to have a general description of what modeling involves, because when you run into problems with your particular instance of modeling, you might find a way around those problems. When you generalize, you stand back and look at your problem from a little further away and realize there's a way over there to the final solution that you wouldn't realize exists if you were very myopic about how you're doing modeling. So with that justification, let's go through what are the three and the only three required components of modeling in general. We're talking about synthetic modeling here, not just in structural biology. The first component that is necessary is what can be called a representation of the model system. A representation of the model system defines its degrees of freedom, its variables, the variables whose values need to be determined. For the protein structure, for example, the degrees of freedom are Cartesian coordinates of each atom in the protein. the model system in general cannot be computed, although it'd be nice if it could. It has to be defined by a scientist based on his or her experience and the needs for which the model is computed. A representation of the molecular network is the nodes, types of the nodes, and the edges, the types of the edges between the nodes. Right? That's a representation for the molecular network, and so on. So that is an important aspect. It's usually revisited quite early in the modeling process, and can be changed. Of course, anything can be changed, but it effectively defines what the modeling question is. The defining variables whose values the model will specify. The second component, major component of the modeling process is a scoring function in general. The scoring function is just a name for a function that takes the input information, or as you'll see, some of the input information, and any model of the system you're modeling, the instance of a model, any protein structure for a protein you're interested in, correct, incorrect, half correct, and returns this function a value that quantifies how consistent is the model with the information incorporated in the scoring function. This is often done by taking the model that you're assessing against the input information and computing what the measurement would give you in the real world if that model was correct, and comparing the computed property of the model with the one that was experimentally measured. And if the difference is small, the scoring function will return a happy value. If the difference between the computed and measured property of the model is large, the scoring function will return unhappy value. Happy values will rank the model higher among the alternative models and vice versa. So the scoring function, in short, is just a scalar function that ranks alternative models based on how consistent they are with the information you have about the system you're modeling. The last component of modeling is a sampling scheme. Obviously, based on what I already said, one needs to suggest alternative models, alternative protein structures to the scoring function so that they can be ranked. And you can do that either by enumeration, sometimes, at some precision. You are systematically generating all possible models if the space of all possible models is small enough and precision is low enough. Or by a sampling or optimization scheme where you only construct a subset of all possible models, but you hope the relevant subset. And that's all there is to it. You can use, for example, in protein structure modeling, a sampling scheme such as a Monte Carlo algorithm, where you almost randomly move components of a model, atoms, let's say, around in space to generate alternative models, each one assessed and ranked by the scoring function. And with that general description of modeling, let's look at one incarnation of modeling, scientific modeling, in particular at structural modeling, or modeling of structures of macromolecular, biomacromolecular systems, complexes of proteins, for example. It's called integrative because, as an aside, because it's based on different types of information, but you can ignore that aspect right now. It's an example of modeling mindset I just introduced to you on the previous slide applied to modeling the structures of macromolecular, biomolecular complexes. So let's identify the three components. Well, maybe let me say, let's define the problem again, a little bit more specifically. The problem is to go from a picture or model of the components of a multi-component system into to a structure of the entire system that defines how the components are positioned and oriented relative to each other. These could be individual protein molecules, and this is an assembly of protein molecules here. So the degrees, the representation, is the shapes of the individual protein subunits positioned in space and oriented in space. The scoring function, in this case, they're represented for most part not the components, that is, not by positions of atoms, but by positions of their secondary structure segments, such as the cylinders here and maybe arrows there, so difficult to see. And just subsets of residues represented with large beads. That's okay. You don't have to use just atoms for structural modeling. Representation defined. The next aspect is the scoring function. It's the function that will allow us to rank alternative such assemblies, alternative juxtapositions of components with respect to each other. Need to be ranked with respect to how consistent they are with what we know about the system. In this case, that's why it's integrative. We have information from schematically indicated for many different kinds of experiments, as well as some computational analysis of the components of the system. So for example, we may also have a crystal of the system that we put into the X-ray beam and measure the diffraction pattern that has to, the measured one, that has to be very similar to the one computed theoretically for any model that we wish to accept. There's other kinds of, as I mentioned, experiments. For example, this one, small angle X-ray scattering, is an experiment with your sample of the complex in solution, also exposed to an X-ray beam, but now we're dealing with a solution sample of the system, not a crystal, and so you get a different, simpler kind of a scattering measurement that you can convert into a radial distribution function of the system. And so any model that you propose for the complex has to have a computed radial distribution function that is sufficiently close to the measured one for the model to be acceptable, and so on. So that's the scoring function in this case. You could say the scoring function includes spatial restraints on the system of interest determined by experiment and theoretical analysis, which then are imposed on the components and the relationships between the components as a sampling scheme, perhaps that Monte Carlo scheme that's pretty mindless, generates the components here, maybe positioned in random locations and orientations initially, and then they are shaken and baked in space through the Monte Carlo process, applying random moves to positions and orientations to generate alternative models for testing by the scoring function. And that's it. As a slightly more detailed illustration of modeling in general, but as it applies to one kind, pretty general kind of macromolecular structure modeling. And I think that what I just told you is what I'd like you to remember the most. So I have another version of the same slide, a slightly different demonstration of more or less the same point that I'll go through a little more quickly to cement it a bit more. So what I described to you can also be broken down into these four stages. These are the experiment and modeling, iteration in science. For structural biology can be broken down into these four steps. First, you gather information by experiment, from statistical inference, from physical theories about the system you're modeling. Maybe in space you have some direct microscopy data and so on. You're then designing the representation of the system. You decide based on your experience, are you going to represent the components of the system as points per atom or as points per protein or something in between. In effect, in a multi-scale representation, you can use different representations for the same part of the system, precisely to allow you to express different kinds of data, different resolutions of different types, most elegantly on the same part of the system. That's possible, for example. And you then, as we discussed, with the representation in hand, encode the different types of data as special restraints on the subset of components, or even on all of the components. You restrain positions, distances, angles, symmetries, proximities, shape, volume, what have you, whatever the data information is informative about. That is encoded in restraints, which are combined into the scoring function for evaluation or ranking of alternative models. And then you're sampling alternative models. You have, say, the Monte Carlo scheme that generates alternative models for ranking rate scoring function. And once you do that, you do have to analyze the results. I haven't pointed that out particularly explicitly so far, but it is important to analyze the results. And in a sense, validate both the data and the model. For example, let me give you a few examples. The types of questions one asks in this fourth stage here. Do you find any models that satisfy all the input information within some threshold? You may not find any such model. That would not be so great. Something went wrong. Multiple reasons exist for that. Maybe your experimental information is incorrect. Maybe your sampling was not powerful enough. Maybe your representation of the system you're modeling was too coarse and the model doesn't have the flexibility to adapt to all the input information, so to speak. You ask the question, do I find only one model? That's a decision that satisfies all the input information. Or perhaps I find many different models that satisfy all the input information. If you find that outcome, most likely you don't have enough information to obtain a single specific, sufficiently precise model. But now you know that, and you may even know what kind of new information would be most helpful to reduce the current uncertainty in the model. You can find that certain subsets of data are repetitively violated, cannot be satisfied by models that otherwise satisfy the preponderance of the data, perhaps highlighting certain experiments that need to be repeated in the lab, and so on and so on. So there's a lot one can learn about the data and the modeling process from this analysis stage, allowing you to go back and repeat the entire modeling experiment cycle until you're either happy with the resulting model or you give up. And for the very end, let me give you now an application to a difficult biological problem of modeling, in fact, of modeling that was formulated as generally as I described to you today, and was only possible to solve because we had this general modeling mindset. It was not possible to solve previously. The problem was to model the structure of the nuclear pore complex, which is an assembly of about 480 proteins of 30 different types that are in multiple copies. It's called 50 megadaltons in size. That's about 5 million atoms. It's a big system. And it's a complex that's very important biologically because it's the gate to the nucleus. It sits in the nuclear envelope, which is what you see here. The gray, the green sphere is the yeast nucleus from an electron microscopy, scanning electron microscopy. And the nuclear pore complexes, these multiple complexes, are these blue rings with holes in the middle. And that's where this macromolecular transport in and out of the nucleus occurs. And we wanted to determine the structure of the complex, meaning first the positions of the atom of the proteins in the complex, so that we could do all these things that in general one wants to do with the model. In this case, find out about how this system might have evolved. It obviously only occurs in eukaryotes that haven't appeared, doesn't occur in prokaryotes. In order to learn about the mechanism of transport through the pore, how is that occurring, how is it regulated. We wanted to learn about how the system assembles and disassembles during the cell cycle and in other contexts as well. We wanted to say about interactions with other systems. There's obviously all sorts of other macromolecules and other molecules around the nuclear complex in the cell. We have the structure of the NPC. We can maybe say some interesting points about interactions with other systems. And finally, yes, we would like to be able to have perhaps small molecules or any kind of molecules that will modify the function of transport through the pore so that you can further study the biology of nucleocytoplasmic transport and maybe why not for therapeutic purposes. So that was our motivation. And here is how it was done at some resolution. It was done by applying the integrity modeling approach that I introduced to you. And so this is just another incarnation of the modeling process that I'm highlighting today. On the outskirts of the slide, you have all the information that went into modeling. We knew the composition of the system and the stoichiometry of the component proteins from so-called quantitative immunoglobulin experiments for each of the protein types. We knew a little bit about the shapes, but not much about each of the individual proteins because almost no X-ray structures were available at the time. From simple classification experiments and very simple bioinformatics analysis, so we could represent the components either as spheres of a certain size or a flexible string of bits, a small number of bits, in some other cases when we judged the proteins were not quite spherical. And then we knew from immunoelectron microscopy experiments with some error bars about the approximate positions in two directions, two projections of each protein from in the context of the NPC. I'm not explaining these experiments right now, but there is a so-called immunoelectron microscopy method, an experimental method, that will give you the approximate position of a protein in the complex using gold-labeled antibodies and so on, which are these backdrops. And then there's other kinds of electron microscopy experiments that tell us about the eightfold symmetry. You see there's an eightfold symmetry to this ring of 456 proteins. There's another twofold symmetry if you look sideways at the complex. So whatever model we generate must reproduce these features here. And finally, a very clever experiment that our collaborators, my partner and Chai, performed that was used for structure characterization for the first time involves breaking apart the entire NPC, the pore complex, but only partly into subcomplexes of maybe, say, 5 proteins, and then detecting what these 5 proteins are through the finite group application in mass spectrometry, and therefore deducing the proximity of the proteins in the native context. So whatever model we generate has to satisfy these measurements as well as much as possible. These are the data in the corresponding spatial restraints. And then, as I said a number of times, you start with a random set of positions for the component proteins, as illustrated in this movie right now, right at the beginning. And then do this Monte Carlo shaking and baking in space of the components, trying to reproduce the localizations, the symmetry, the shapes, the proximities that were defined by the spatial restraints themselves, defined by hard experimental data. And in fact, if you do this a very large number of times, hundreds of thousands of times, because it's a stochastic optimization, you will find solutions, structures at the end of such a sampling trajectory that satisfy the input restraints very well. In fact, you only find solutions that are similar to each other at the precision of about 5 nanometers. There's no solutions other than the solution represented with this colored density map, where different proteins are indicated by blobs of different color that satisfy the input information. And that's it. So that's the model that you obtain with this general process of converting input information into the output model by satisfying spatial restraints encoded in the scoring function, with those ranking alternative models obtained by a sampling process. None of the individual types of information would come even close to allowing you to compute a model at this precision. But when you put everything together in this way, you can do so. So that was actually my last real slide. I would like to come back to the advertisement of an effort for computing a good, quote unquote, model of the cell, and emphasize that yet again. It is an opportunity that's at the forefront, but it is on this side of reality now, on our side of reality. It's timely. We are poised to engage. And I hope that I illustrated to you, I certainly tried to, that in order to get to a model of the cell, we will need to, first of all, involve modeling very explicitly, in addition to all sorts of experiments. And that this modeling will be at least in part structural, and that it should be formal, not guessing in our heads, but done through algorithms. And importantly, it will depend on all sorts of experiments, as well as physical theories, as well as statistical inference. And obviously, since it's the cell that is large, as well as small, in some respects, from atoms to hundreds of thousands of nanometers, and leaves on the time scales from femtoseconds in terms of some events that matter, the vibrations of atoms, for example, 2 hours or maybe even longer, the lifespan of the organism. We will have to do some fancy modeling to get to a desirable model of itself, but hopefully inspired by at least some points I was making today. And the very last thing I'd like to highlight is that is this collaborative nature of science. That when you are faced with big problems, it leads, maybe not always, but often, especially in biology, you need large teams of scientists to address them. And in our case in particular, we are computational biologists. We depend on collaborating with experimentalists who generate the data for us to compute models and to test models and to add value to science with our models in general. And so over the years, we collaborated with many experimentalists, many of which are listed in this list. I would also like to highlight that there are now 5 Indian postdocs in our research group currently. All of whom are involved in one or another aspect of integrative structure modeling, or integrative modeling in some cases of networking networks as well. And finally, I'd like to also acknowledge Madhu, MS Madhusudan, one of my hosts today, my main host for the trip to India, who was a postdoc also in our group previously, although he didn't work on integrative modeling, so his name doesn't appear here. But perhaps most importantly, there's a combination of two facts about him that you should know for your own inspiration. He was a graduate from the physics department of CUNY University, and he's now a faculty member of the Indian Institute for Science Education and Research. So, a nice iteration for him as well. And thank you very much for your attention.